Greetings.
Hey sister, how you doing? Did you know that you're beautiful? Hey sister, there ain't no choosing. Did you know that you're beautiful?
Greetings, Nama Alaikum, Namaste, SSS, Barwani, and this goes on. My name is Kaika Matasia and you are here on the Eyeame channel. Welcome to our Winter Wellness series, where we find out a variety of ways that assist us in bettering our health during the colder months. So today's discussion, we are talking about emotional health and our emotional well-being. And I have brought on one delicious character, my sister. So sis, please introduce yourself.
Hi, I am Deanne. I am Kaika's sister.
So I want to do this exercise where oftentimes when we're asked how we are, the response is automatically fine, but I want to actually take a body plan, a body scan, and see how is your heart today, how is your mind today?
My heart's very full today. I'm feeling really satisfied with what I've been doing recently. Everything's going really well for me. My mind is telling me to rest. I'm very tired and that's starting to affect my sleep and my self-esteem. So I need to listen to both of these things, honour both things and be proud of myself but also rest. But how are you? How is your mind? How is your heart?
My mind... The word soothing, I don't know, that's the one that came up to me. I feel in a really soothed space. I've been taking my sleep hygiene quite seriously recently over the last 2 to 3 weeks. And so I slow down, I put my phone down, I let my candle be on, I have my salt lamp on, I read, and that has really been helpful. So that's how I'm feeling today, sis. Let's get into these questions. The first one being, what does emotional health mean to you?
Emotional health for me is linked with emotional intelligence. So being able to name, label, however you want to talk about it, put like a name to the feeling. So some people use words, some people use pictures, some people use sounds. It's just being able to be aware of this feeling in my body, this feeling in my mind, this is what this feels like. This is sadness. I feel sad. I feel, or I feel a rainbow. All of these things. And just being aware of the timings of when you feel like this. Like, is there a pattern? Is it when you haven't slept that you start to feel like this? Is it when someone says something unkind to you that you start to feel like this? Is it when you're doing really well that you start to feel like this? I think emotional health is just honouring all of your feelings. They aren't good, they aren't bad. Allow them space and then release them gently, like you do all things.
That's very similar for me. I think emotional health is being non-judgmental towards the experience. Oftentimes we're told that be happy, be joyous, don't cry. It's like, well, actually for me, I cry often. I enjoy crying. Crying is not an indication all the time that means I'm sad or I'm depressed. More time than I'm crying, it's an indication that I'm feeling intensely. And I also think that emotional health means enjoying the whole spectrum of emotions and not being flooded by them, not being bombarded by them. Like, in a way, having an element of objection, knowing that today is a horrible day, like one thing after the other is not going well, but it's just today. It doesn't mean that I'm a horrible person. It doesn't mean that all of these things that are happening that are not so positive is because of my own doing. Emotions are like, this is external stimuli that's happening outside of me, and once I experience it, I experience it through the filter of emotion. So it lets me navigate what is something I need to continuously engage in, what should I engage in. When I'm feeling, when I dance, that's an external stimuli to a certain extent. I have this filter of sensuality, of pleasure, of enjoyment, of fulfillment. So I know that I need to dance often in order to feel that emotion, yeah? Okay, how did you come to this understanding or connection with your emotional health? Was there a life experience that inspired this or brought this on?
Yes, essentially my marriage ended. So when it did, I prioritised myself, and that meant taking my mental health seriously. So for me, my mental health and my emotional health, I've accessed both of these at the same time. It meant really sitting with and acknowledging how I am feeling. And my journey has been diagnoses and holistic therapies and medication, and I've gone about things in a very, I've tried lots of different things, but ultimately I think it's when you put your focus on your inside, how am I feeling inside, which I think I started to access different things like art therapies and laughter yoga and mindfulness, working on my self-belief and my self-esteem and all of these things. It's just the same message really of, how do I feel right now? What do I feel like in the present? The more I made time by showing up to classes and scheduling, okay, right, this is the time I'm setting aside to give my all to this session, to sit with my emotions and listen to other people's emotions and have them honoured and respected in a safe place, the more that I did that, like, the easier it became for me. So now I can really quickly identify, oh, I'm feeling this, like, oh, don't really like that, whereas it would spiral in the past. I can just say, oh, you know what, I'm gonna go, I need to go and dance, or oh, don't like this, let me go and paint or do something else. But you've been doing this a long time anyway. You've been doing this since we were little.
That's interesting, because as you're talking, I'm thinking, when was my when did I begin? And I don't really have a definitive age or time or experience that happened. So please share on my behalf.
I think you've always been very sure of yourself, but I know that your emotions were like, if you're crying, you're crying. If you're feeling joyful, you're feeling joyful. I feel things very intensely, and they weren't that. All of my emotions were not always celebrated in the way that I would have appreciated them when I was younger. As an adult, it's something that I'm having to unlearn, and as a mother, it's something that I'm having to unlearn quickly. It's important for everybody to feel their emotions and have them acknowledged and honoured and respected, and I think when they're not, it can be really difficult to manage, like rage and anger, things that are like normal and healthy and useful. I have to work to be able to feel those things, if that makes sense. Does that make sense?
No, that makes sense, absolutely, 1000%. And as I said, we live in a world that just constantly restricts the experience, restricts, reduces, minimizes the human experience. We are constantly being told how to feel, how to think, what to wear, what to eat. And so it makes sense that a young child's anger goes against ageism. So I completely understand. And similar to you, I grew up thinking that to be angry meant that it was uncontrolled. And for me, control and discipline was so important. But I then realized anger is needed, and I enjoy being angry. And I think one of the powerful things about anger is that it lets people know a boundary has been overstepped. Don't play games with me. But if we're too busy inhibiting that, people don't know that they're walking up and down on your boundaries. So when you say, yo, well, bro, we did it, that's not going to run for me, yeah? It lets people know so that your cup stays full and you don't have to break somebody else.
I like how it gives you, like, focus. When you're angry, you can only focus on this, and all the politeness goes out the window, and all of the coddling goes out the window. It's just like, I think anger is like the most primal human emotion that is. Anger, rage, and feeling that all through your body. Like, you know how you feel when you're angry, when you're furious. I'm working on that.
You get that, sis. I know. You will get them. Okay, so did you have anyone that taught or support your emotions?
Younger, I think I used to share with you a lot, and I think that you had created a space like bunk beds, or, you know, over the years. I think, like, underneath the blanket, sharing, like, that was like my first proper experience of, like, okay, this feeling is okay, and this thought is okay, and all of the things that I would bring are okay, and I'm still loved regardless. So that's as a child. As an adult, I think definitely more art therapy sessions, and I do sessions with and I think they have been like instrumental in showing up for myself, and that safe space being inside me, not just physical, like in this room at Thursday at 10, like it's in here all the time. Really honored my emotional health as a child. But how did you nurture and honor baby Nax's emotions, and how does that differ from then to now?
I don't think I honored my emotions. I had no choice but to feel them. I can't really express it because we are surrounded by like ration and logic and reason. When I tell people that I live by my emotions, they automatically think that I'm insane. I specifically recall one time when I was in college, I was in my psychology class, and I was saying to my friends, they're thinking, like, oh, why wasn't you here yesterday? And so I got on the bus, I was coming, and the spirit told me no, so I had to go back home. So I think that like pretty much summarizes how my emotions, or how I allowed for my emotions to influence my life. I felt them fully, which has been both a good thing and a bad thing. So yeah, really, I think the transition between adulthood and childhood, or rather childhood and adulthood, is the why. I know why. If I feel down, matter of fact, yesterday I had like a bout of downness, and I realized I had to take my supplement. I take a vitamin D supplement, which I actually want to talk about in another video for the series. I didn't take the supplement, and around like 6, 7pm, I was doing a quick check-in with myself, and I was like, I don't feel normal. And I was thinking, like, okay, what happened? I did journal, I did meditate, I danced, I spent time with family, I hugged, I did this, I haven't eaten mushrooms, maybe that is. Do you know what? I didn't have my vitamin D supplement. Okay, say no more. Tomorrow I'll make extra money. And look at me, I feel delicious just today. I think that's the difference.
I think joy just comes a lot easier to children, and they make time for it, whereas in adults we don't necessarily do that. And I think it's really something that's helped me is that the things that you love doing when you're a child, if you do them in your adulthood, it can help you tap into that joy.
I feel like you kind of touched on this, yeah, but correct me if I'm wrong. What has been the outcome of living with emotions that have not been prioritized?
I have had my boundaries like danced over, let's use the polite word. I've had my boundaries absolutely been taking the mick with, because I have felt so much shame around how I'm feeling, because I've not had my emotions taken seriously as a child. It meant in the interactions I have as an adult, I'm just continuing that kind of path. But it's meant that I'm now surrounded by people that are not in touch with who they are, and it's meant that I've been stuck or capped. So when I'm looking at things as they are, like we're in two different spaces. Like if I'm trying to be here and you're not seeing an issue with here, I've had to like lovingly leave them where they are. But it's good, because then it means that when you're on the same wavelength as people, there's less miscommunication. It has its perks now, but it was very lonely in the beginning.
The journey to self is a lonely one. Similar to you, I've had my boundaries walked over on, even though theoretically I had these really strong concrete boundaries and I often verbalized them. When it comes to putting them into practice, they weren't really practicing. And so as I get older, as I reach different stages of womanhood, different stages of understanding myself, I realized that if we are atoms in a petri dish and we collide, we're supposed to collide. And if we repel, then we repel. But the likelihood is if we are like each other, we will collide again. The next question is, what would you tell, teach, or advocate for your younger self? So if you could talk to 15-year-old version of you, or even 5-year-old BB, what would you say?
I think I tell myself only that it will get better, and that I will find a space where people will be accepting, like-minded, and celebrate how in touch I am with my emotions. I think I would just say to wait, to still feel what I'm feeling, and not to be discouraged because my immediate surroundings is not as vocal about their support as I might have liked to hear at the time. Because I think the person that I was when I was little, I am getting back in touch with that person because that person knew who they were.
I would tell my 5-year-old self, if it gets too much, just break down and cry. If somebody takes your toy, them up. And if you want to enjoy that slice of cake, enjoy it. Feel everything to the fullest. Like, why are we hiding? Why are we denying the intensity? Feel all of it. Okay, sis, but I finished my question. Do you have any for me?
Yeah, I've been on my emotional wellness journey for about a year now, so I've just started. But what tips or tricks do you have for people who may just be starting out too?
The first thing would be to not judge your emotions. Do not judge them, good or bad, positive or negative. Allow for yourself to feel them completely. That's the first thing. The next thing is, it somewhat contradicts what I normally say, but there needs to be an element of objectivity. Like, do not let your anger make you lose work. Do not let your sadness make you not have an assignment on time. Do not make your happiness or your pleasure or your joy make you be intimate with someone that you otherwise wouldn't be. Be conscientious, be mindful whilst having your emotions. Don't condemn them, write them down, write your emotions down, and try to start formulating or identifying if there's a pattern. So if you spend a certain amount of time with this group of friends, do you normally feel high after, or do you feel low? Or if you have engaged with this family member, if you've done this form of exercise, how do you feel after that? How do you feel in the daytime? How do you feel in the nighttime? Start writing these things down, because it just allows for you to do more of your Eyeame work. It allows for you to identify your patterns. And with being able to identify that, you can then make decisions. So for example, I know, as I don't think I've even expressed this, but we will go into detail as the series goes on. Both of us, if you're happy for me to say it, sis, suffer from seasonal affective disorder. And so I know that I can't do as much in the winter as I can in the summer. I cannot stretch myself out, and that's because I've been taking active time to journal how I feel, and I can compare how I feel according to the season. So I think that's it. One, feel your emotions, don't judge them. Two, be conscientious while you're experiencing these emotions and have an element of detachment to them.
What would you say to people who are supporting people who suffer from seasonal affective disorder?
Okay, so whenever anybody's going to become involved in another person's wellness, again, I think the term is healthy detachment. There needs to be a healthy detachment. So that's just the premise. Being an open ear is so helpful. Paying attention to what it is that they're saying. And also, if you have the ability to do this without forcing advice and offering your opinion, sometimes we just need space. Sometimes we just need ears. Sometimes we just need to feel listened to. So I think that's a really helpful resource. Another thing that you can do is identify their patterns. It could be in the evening that you see their emotions start to become weighed down, in which case, make it a point of duty to say, listen, 7 p.m. to 7:30, we're going to watch a comic every single night. So at least you know that you've put a smile on their face, some kind of laughter has been invoked daily. It's so essential because it releases certain hormones. If you can just start to clock small little patterns, if you know that they like hot chocolate, but they don't have the energy, or they're so fatigued that they can't do it, you can offer that to them. Sometimes asking people, yo, sis, brother, king, queen, lover, what do you need from me? How can I assist you during these times? People know what they need because they'll say in their darkest moments, just need to sleep. Oh my God, I'm so hungry. Like, so just pay attention to that. That would be my response.
Yeah, and I think that would be fantastic to hear as somebody who does suffer from SAD. What advice do you have for people that are navigating relationships or interactions with people that are not as in tune with their emotions as themselves?
Okay, so the first thing is to educate people. If they are open, if they are willing to hear, you can explain to them, okay, so we can have conversations that are emotionally healthy in this way, as opposed to becoming aggressive and defensive. Let's try actually communicating. Or if we can't communicate verbally, how about I write down what I'm thinking, you write down what you're thinking, we exchange letters, and maybe we'll be able to understand it that way. Let us have half an hour to calm down, and then we can converse that way. That's if the people are opening to hearing. In which case, if they're not, I think it seems like it's a repetitive term, detachment. And sometimes it's not that deep. So that's what my response would be. Educate, if not, subtly excuse yourself.
What can you add or sprinkle into your routine for this winter to keep, to up that self-care?
I want to make a video about this separately, specifically to all the things that I know and all the things that I'll be incorporating. But the three things that have come to my mind is movement. Movement, whenever you move, it doesn't matter. It could be stretching, it could be sprinting, it could be gymnastics, yoga, self-defense. Movement always makes you feel good. Engaging in something that's positive for you specifically. So for me, that would be reading, for example. Reading makes me feel special. It allows me to enter a new world. I feel at peace when I read. I don't feel like I'm wasting my time on my phone. I feel productive when I read, whether it be a novel, self-help. I always enjoy reading. For others, it might be going out to a bar. It might be snugging up with your partner. It might be, you know what? This is actually something, it just came to my mind. Having sex, we all know the amount of hormones it releases. It releases that good feeling if it's done with the correct people. You know, if you're taking your time with it, the amount of pleasure, oxytocin, all that's released, it has such a cooling impact and a warming impact on your body. Please let me just premise that we honor the legal minimum age, that it is amongst consenting adults that respect each other bare minimum, that enjoy each other, that are ensuring that both people's pleasures are met, and love would be an additional delicious bonus. And the third thing, so what I said movement, sex, and doing something that is pleasurable specifically for you. So those are just a few tips that we can incorporate into our routine to better our duration of this winter season. Yes, okay. So sis, how was that for you?
That was really good, very informative. It was very interesting to see how much further I've come than I thought I did. So that was really interesting. And it was nice to get some tips and tricks because God knows I need them.
You know what I admire the most about how our connection is evolving? But I think because I'm the big sister, naturally I used to give you advice. But now, as our age doesn't seem to be such an important factor of our dynamic, like it's a lot more yin and yang. We both advise each other. We're both each other's advisors and counselors and students and pupils. So that would be my favorite part. Alrighty, so sis, thank you so much for joining us for this conversation. Sincerely appreciate it.
Thank you.
No problem. Okay, bless up everybody. I hope you enjoyed. Please like, comment, share, and subscribe. And add any tips, any hacks, any advice, your comments in the comment section below. Let's start having a conversation, an open dialogue about this, because it matters. And I don't care, people talk about depression and people talk about anxiety, but seasonal affective disorder, I don't really hear it being discussed as much. So let's just open up that dialogue. Alrighty then, bless up, take care.
And remember, I am in everything.